are you gonna do?
I was lonely and afraid.
We don't choose whom we love.
The Lord of Light has made good on his promise, my king.
Siege begins at sunrise.
You're no one.
You betrayed her.
If I'm going to die, let it happen while there's still some of me left.
This is it. Long awaited, much feared. Episode 10, Season 5, Mother's Mercy, the end of Season 5 of Game of Thrones. Cenk Uygur, John Iadarola, Ben Mankiewicz. So, one of the producers here, a high-ranking official here at TYT, Mike Shekels, has a lot of responsibilities. Comes and sits in that chair right there as we're prepping the shoot. He's like, Jon Snow thing got stuck onto the end. I didn't like it. Like, after nothing happened. Nothing happened. Everything happened. Like,
we should probably fire him as a result of that. That's the crazy
thing.
It's just
a list of things that happened.
With no notes.
With no notes. Jon Snow is the last two words. Yeah. I ran out of space. I have to put Cersei and Jon Snow on the same line.
That's crazy.
Yeah. And he started writing smaller as he got to the bottom of the page.
I started writing smaller. That's right.
I wanted a payoff on episode 10, which doesn't usually happen. It usually happens in episode 9, sometimes 8, etc. I got what I was asking for, which goes to the old adage, be careful what you wish for, you just might get it.
Yeah. So, yeah, I like that they broke the normal pattern of 9 super exciting, then 10's resolution. Instead, they put some of the exciting stuff before, some of it after. So because people started to sort of guess when things would happen based on the previous seasons. I don't really like that. I like it to be somewhat
random.
Right.
So Game of Thrones, the episode order.
It's pretty meta.
All right, so let's start with Jon Snow, because I presume we'll come back to it. So let's just get it going. I had read a story. We're going to talk some about stuff that you've read that doesn't have to do with the show. Just let you people know. Mm-hmm. So I read an interview with Kit Harington that I just stumbled across on Huffington Post about how, and it said, spoilers, it's going to mention what happens in the books. And in the books, similar things happen.
He gets basically stabbed, the same
stabbed
thing happens.
By his guys on the Night's Watch.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But it is unclear, as I read in the books, whether he lives or dies.
I mean, that's the ending.
It ends. So he gets stabbed.
And it's probably less, like, you see a lot of him laying there and blood leaking out. In the books, it's basically he gets stabbed in the back. Somebody might say something to him. It's a little bit vague in my memory now. And then they basically cut. Like, he got stabbed multiple times, and you're led to believe that that's probably fatal. But in the show, I mean, that's a dead man laying there.
It looks like a dead man lying there. It looks like a guy losing a lot of blood. But in that story, it was that he is signed for season 6 with an option in season 7, that he's one of the actors signed. And so I had read that, and I was, of course, then super confident. I'm like, oh, he's going to get stabbed by guys on the Night's Watch here. I'm like, but he's fine. he doesn't look fine. He looks dead. And he says now in interviews that he did that were released afterwards, look, I'm dead. He says, there is a line in there. He's like, as far as I know, I'm dead. I'm not coming back.
So
let's get to the...
I have an explanation.
Yeah, I think we all have the same explanation. I mean, it seems worth mentioning that, what's her name, Melisandre?
Melisandre.
That Melisandre just shows up there on the morning before Jon Snow dies.
Oh,
well, no,
she just
I
wants to
of
piss off
all.
The edge of the world, just like Tyrion. She's there for the view, the food.
Right, totally.
Oh, no, I didn't think about that at all. That's an excellent point. No, my point was, he might come back in season 7 as one of the Army of the Dead.
Mm. Yes.
And you don't want to see Jon Snow with, what is it, claw? With it, what's
long
a
claw.
Long claw with blue eyes.
But long claw is what killed... That's the name of his sword.
Yeah, yeah. It killed the White Walker.
Oh, right, that's right. So the, I got confused there for a second. Good. So, of course that's possible. Everybody was waiting to see whether his eyes would go white, and they obviously, I think, held on that shot just to give us moments of like, even though it doesn't really make any sense. That
why it would happen then.
Why it would happen then, but you're still like, you know, or blink, do something, you know? But I think, I don't know why Melisandre arrives there if it's not potentially to save Jon Snow, and I think that this is exactly what they want, that people will be speculating about this. Very hard to keep stuff like this a secret, though, and he says, I'm not on season 6, but he did also have a caveat in there as far as I know, and they say, hey, look, he's dead. But, of course, they're not, the show producers say he's dead, but if he's dead and is revived by Melisandre, they're not lying.
Yeah, and also he's not
the Lord of the Light. The Lord can revive
right
people
that guy. We've talked about that thing with the five.
Although, you go, folks, hope
as we've seen before, they always come back as something less than what they were each time they're revived.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, the guy said it. The other one, like you feel spread thin, kind of. The more times you come back, and the injuries like remain basically.
Right, except that guy came back like 28 times. Yeah, and he seemed like he was okay.
Yeah,
right.
Like but also John could certainly handle one.
Yeah, and he wasn't a bad guy. Like there being less of him didn't turn him more evil.
No, it didn't.
For my sake, it's not like I'm like a fanboy. Like, oh no, don't kill John Snow. I just think that. Like, it's a possibility. Yeah. They've set up a scenario under the rules of this show where that guy, thanks to the Lord of the Light, who I've, besmirched through the entire episode and might come through in this case.
Although, to be fair, we've never seen that she is able to do that. We understand that followers of that god or whatever can.
But John also is with not a follower of that god.
Yeah, he's not. Well, as far as I know, neither was, what's his face? The guy who kept coming back. I forget his name. But also,
I bet he was after the first time.
Yeah. But when we talk about let's see. So if she does bring him back, then what Jon Snow said or what the Kit Harington said would not have actually been a lie. But here's the thing: they can lie.
Yeah, right.
If they want to lie, they can lie. They're not priests.
Right.
So the thing with Jon Snow dying is that everybody is distraught over it. But I was thrilled is too strong a word. But I was happy is too strong a word as well. Mm-hmm. But I thought, okay, this is Game of Thrones. This is what I bargained for.
Right.
So, I don't know why people are surprised. I mean, again, it was the most foreshadowing Game of Thrones has ever done, right? And so we knew it was coming when Ollie came and said, oh, Uncle Benji, took me half a second to go, right?
Yeah, right.
And then when I saw Alistair Thorne and he backed it up, I was like, oh, no.
It's over.
Right?
Yeah.
There's no Benjen.
And they had a cool line for the watch. Yeah. For the watch.
They had the traitor thing, so he gets to realize it for a second.
Yeah, yeah.
I would have liked him to get his sword in his hand or something.
For the watch.
The lack of logic in people in every show, and it's not the show's fault, that's just it is what it is. It drives me crazy. Mm-hmm. Snails on a chalkboard.
Lack of logic of fans or lack of logic of characters?
No, of the people, the characters in the show. Hey, the Night's Watch, you fucking morons. You just heard the story about how the White Walkers raised the dead. Yeah. So every wildling that is now beyond the wall, you would have had to fight when they were an invincible part of an invincible army.
Yeah.
What more evidence do you need that Jon Snow was right? How could you possibly be that stupid and illogical?
It turns out.
Do we know that he told them?
Right.
It seems crazy that he wouldn't, but we know that Jon Snow is terrible at explaining the context of his decisions.
It seems that he had to have told them because he...
The other guys had to have told them. Yeah, you can't
believe
what happened.
There were other Night's Watch people,
The other Night's Watch people. And then he goes what? And they all rise.
And the wildlings, some of them are going to be like, yeah, I got it. You guys are unhappy we're here. Guess what we just saw?
exactly.
At some point, humans are going to have a conversation about the biggest event that ever happened in their lives. Right?
That's maybe ever happened in the history of the Earth.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And even if they didn't miraculously have that conversation, then I'm equally angry that they weren't logical enough to have that conversation immediately.
Yeah. But
and in fact, I'm pissed at Jon Snow, too, just because as he's talking to Sam Tarly, there was a moment there when the camera was just on him, and you didn't know who he was talking to. And I was like, please be telling everyone.
He raised his hands. And they all stood up at once. Tens of thousands of them, the biggest army in the world.
Like, you convene people immediately and go, here's what happened. You guys are pissed that these guys are here, but they were going to come here one way or another. We got to be happy that they don't have blue eyes because they're on our army because they saw the same thing, right? And instead of fighting us. And if people are like, oh, I'm still mad, I go, okay, duly noted, that guy's a fucking moron, and he's on my list for watch your back because there's no way you can get through his thick skull, right?
Yeah. But
Jon Snow is like too Ned Starky.
Right, he's like his dad.
Honor will prevail.
Right.
Have you not watched the series?
By the way, maybe smartest character of the episode was Sam Tarly. Boy, does he know when to leave a... Jump off of the sinking ship.
Oh, yeah, because he totally sees what's going to happen. We're all going to die. They're going to die. I'm going to die trying to save them. She's going to look disappointed in me. It's going to be the worst thing that ever happened.
Great lines.
Why don't we just skip that part?
Right. No, I love that. I'm glad he got out of Dodge.
Of course. Yeah, everybody should. And you like, you know, what we were taught in episode one or whenever we first met the wall, like, they're rapists, murderers, and thieves, and unrepentant ones frequently. Like, they're sociopaths. So they don't listen. They don't care. They think they've got, you know, they think they're invincible. They're like, I hear you, army, invincible army. They're not getting over the wall. Yeah. Nobody gets over the wall.
Yeah. It's a great irony we've never discussed that, like, the most immoral people in the kingdom have now taken the most sacred oath, you know?
Yeah, right. It's so
dumb. So, and works, and anyone who violates that oath is supposed to be put to death, like Ned Stark did of the guy who ran, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Anyone who sleeps with a woman. I mean, there was a brief moment when Sam Tarly tells Jon Snow, I'm like, well, you should execute him.
Jon Snow's the sort of person who might.
Right, and I'm like, he is that Ned Starky idiot, right?
No, but they've Yeah, but he wouldn't do that because he'd done it. I mean, and Ned wouldn't have killed the guy if Ned had also run. Like they, you know.
Yeah, and plus we know that they routinely go to that mole's town.
And obviously, if you're going to have rules about desertion, we know that's the most important rule. I mean, the leaders at least have gotten that part, and they all know, right, they all know they go into that town and...
Yeah,
and they all know having sex with women is the least important rule.
Right.
And I love the cheesy grin on Sam's face. But I also like that they turn on him. The one thing I wish they could have shown more of from the books was that they didn't really show too much of Jon Snow being a good leader. Like, they show him doing unpopular things, but they don't show really much counterpoint on why people would follow him. Whereas in the books, he sends crews to man the other castles along the wall. Like, he builds it up. He's doing all this planning for food for the winter. Like, he does these good things that would lead you to believe that some people should support him. In the show, there's not really much reason for people to back him. And he does seem very alone in the show, which I guess is good. But I don't know. I feel like it could have been more well-rounded.
Yeah, I mean, he's clearly a good leader. The wildling guy.
Tormund
clearly, you know, he recognized that, and he said,
so did Mance Rayder, so did the Maester.
So did Stannis.
Right, yeah. So all the smart people recognize
that. Right.
The idiots, Dad, you brought wildlings! Yeah, they kill him. I got it. And Ollie, I don't blame him. He's a kid, his parents died.
Yeah.
Ollie, I pardon you. Okay.
But we were totally right. I mean, Ollie Omar'd him.
Yeah.
I expected that he would be the first dagger in the back or something.
Yeah,
but also very, very small things. But usually in that sort of situation, they use little daggers. You stab them. Those were fucking long ass daggers. I like that.
Think about the, like Jon Snow. Like, I mean, never has a person died worse. I lean toward we're not done with him, but he's so alone. Like Sam had left him. Everyone had left him. Aemon had died. Like, and these, you know, and then Ollie, this kid who he mentored the way. He had mentored Arya, you know, and then cared about and looked out for, and then he's just like dead in a cold snow, killed by guys who were supposed to be with him.
That he
was trying to save.
Under a sign that says traitor.
Under a sign
that says traitor. When they're the traitors.
When they're the traitors. They're literally committing.
Maybe that's what they meant.
The definitive act of treason.
Yeah. Well, I mean, there's allusions there to Caesar, obviously. Mm-hmm. I mean,
to
Ali.
Right.
But I beyond that, I have nothing. Okay, don't get me wrong. Yeah. And then, because...
Right.
Okay,
the barbarians and blah, blah, blah.
If Melisandre brings him back to life, he owes her one. They should have sex immediately.
You know what, incredibly beautiful woman? I'm going to do you this favor.
That's right. You know, since you rose me from that, I have also arisen. Okay. So, number three, when I thought Jon Snow was dead for good, before we started this review and you guys said Melisandre, I hadn't thought of it, right? Mm. And I thought, we set up that whole thing about how he's a Targaryen and isn't that amazing? And then they just kill him. So then, but what was interesting to me is that I appreciated the show for killing him, as I was saying earlier, and I didn't mind it that much. I'm like, look,
I
bought into major characters that I hear all the time. I bought into no one is untouchable. The only person that seems a little untouchable is Daenerys, and every once in a while she seems like she's touch and go, right?
Right.
Because she's got to come back with the dragons, right? Mm-hmm. And so... But Jon Snow, I thought, was eminently touchable.
Yeah.
Right?
I think Tyrion is untouchable.
Tyrion's close.
Close, yeah.
But that's only a matter of TV.
Totally, that's right.
You see, and storytelling. Not as a matter of a plot point. Like, if Tyrion dies, no plot point changes.
None.
Right?
Yeah,
but you have to drag, you have to have the Song of Fire and Ice. And Daenerys' fire, if you kill the fire, Jesus Christ, what the hell, right?
At this point, though, I feel at least, like, Daenerys' chances of getting to Westeros and uniting people, blah, 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 I think that rides very heavily on Tyrion. Like, I think he's exactly what she needs. I think that she's, like, teetering on the brink with dealing with some of the tragedies, and she's shown that core of ruthlessness and bloodthirstiness to some extent that she has, and I think that he's exactly what tempers that. I think that if he dies, she might still do some of the things, but I think that her decisions would be slightly different.
I mean, like,
it'd be worse for the people.
Like, Varys and Jorah and Eric Bana Jr. can help her, right?
Varys,
but
yeah.
They can help, but, like, Varys knows that, look, I'm smart. I'm as smart as anybody, but Tyrion has this other thing that I don't have.
Mm-hmm.
That, yeah.
So, well, that ties in perfectly to the next comment I was going to make about Jon Snow. I'm fine with Jon Snow dying if that's what happened. What, to me, my favorite character now by a landslide is Varys. And so the one that no one else cares about, I feel like, is on. If you kill Varys, why am I watching this
right,
show?
Right.
Like, I love Varys so much, I accidentally saw a picture of him when he looks like a real person, mm-hmm. not the Varys outfit. Obviously, he's an actor, right? And I felt betrayed. I'm like,
but
that's no.
He
you
uses
can't have
disguises.
You can't have a beard and hair and stuff like that and be a real person. You're Varys. Go back to being Varys, right? So, in all the moments of this episode, by far my favorite was when Varys re-enters and him and Tyrion have that conversation. I literally twice went yes when I saw him. I went yes when they had their lovely back and forth. Yeah. I was like. Well, that's what I love. That's the Game of Thrones, right? It's and I told Wendy, my wife sat down next to me. She doesn't watch Game of Thrones, but she's like, "What are you so excited about?" I'm like, "That's the guy who never fights, has no balls, okay,
literally.
And is my favorite character in this incredibly violent show."
Yeah, yeah. Right. And what's great about him is that he talks about how easy it was for him to just show up there. He could have shown up at the Wall or Dorne, for all we know, mm-hmm. and it would be kind of understandable.
Yeah.
But again, just for the stakes for the North, like again, if Jon Snow does end up dying, I'm gonna be mad to some extent. It's okay, but we do have to bear in mind the stakes. Like if he's not there, then assuming that Castle Black, the Night's Watch, attack the wildlings, they're doomed. And that's, the world is doomed.
No, okay, so that's exactly, gets to my, what I think is my last point about Jon Snow, which is that, okay, now we got a battle on our hands. Before, you know, I've been super skeptical about ice. I've always been on the side of fire, right? Look, dragon glass can beat you, Valyrian steel can beat you, fire can beat you. I'm not that intimidated by you guys, right? Like, I've said this a million times. Wait a minute. Now we got a battle on our hands. Because, first of all, they've got an army of 10,000, the largest the world has ever seen, according to Jon Snow, in this episode. So that gives you context. It's the largest army the world has ever seen.
Yeah.
Right,
well, John,
and they're already
thinking,
dead.
Right, they're not. They have no problem just rushing
dying
something.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Technically, there are bigger armies over in Essos, but he's very provincial. He only knows about Westeros.
Okay, of course. I was thinking. Sorry,
Sir Khalasar is at 40,000.
Technically, there are bigger armies over at Essos, but they're mostly provincial. I don't think we need to concern. We don't know who those people are on the show.
No, I mean, you see the armies of, like, Khal Drogo. He had more than 10,000 people. Like,
actually,
God, read some history books.
Actually.
Fuck. Go to Old Town. They have the biggest library in the world.
I was just going
to
say that's because John just came from the Citadel.
Yeah. Okay. I'm a meister.
So now, though, they have this huge army. Jon Snow, the only smart person within, you know, a three, what do they call those province perimeter? Three realm perimeter, right? He's gone. Stannis, who rode to the rescue last time, he's gone, right? Mm-hmm. The Boltons, they'll probably join the guys. Right? They're like, oh, you're killing in people. And then they'd be like, yes, we're in, right? Ramsay can't wait to have blue eyes.
Right.
So. I mean, they're going to run through the North, like, ironically, like a hot knife through butter.
Yeah.
Like a cold knife through butter in this case. And then what's left in the South to fight them, right? Total disorganization. Dragons that won't listen. Daenerys now kidnapped by the Scottish Dothraki. Whoever those guys were, right?
Right.
And so now I think, like, yeah, score one for Ice. Mm. All of a sudden, we got a ball game on our hands.
Right. Mm. Ice is now they're like plus 115.
Yeah, because not only that, by the time they've gotten to the Red Keep, they will have not an army of 10,000, an army of what, 100,000?
Yeah,
a million. 10,000.
It doesn't seem like enough. There seemed like 10,000 Boltons.
Yeah.
When they swarm Stannis.
Thousands at the very least. But
But all those are going to be on their side because there's no way any of them is stopping the Army of the Dead. Right? So when they're walking in with the entire population of the North and a giant with blue eyes, right? And, one other thing that's super important is the dragons appear to be incredibly killable, right?
That's right.
Three spears and he was teetering.
Yeah,
right?
He's pretty messed up.
Yeah, and so. No, I'm not plus 15. I had a fire at minus 400 earlier. Now it's flipped all the way to like Ice is at plus 185, plus 215. They are heavily favored at this point.
That's where I'd put them.
So here's some theory. What I was going to say earlier when I forgot was that John was pretty strong about he's not in season 6. He didn't say I'm off the show. Although it appears that they told him, he says they gave him the, Kit Harington says, they gave him the Tony Soprano walk. Mostly in Game of Thrones, they don't tell you when your character's going to die. But they felt apparently that Kit needs to know, and they gave him the hey, here's what's going to happen. This is great. And he said pretty clearly, I'm not on season 6. Mm-hmm. So if he does come back, first of all, none of that might be true. But if he does come back, it might be 7. He had that contract thing where he apparently was signed for season 6 with an option for 7, as I said. That's why I thought it. But here are some of the things, and this goes to your, here was in the books. John wargs into Ghost. That is one of the possibilities fans are trotting out. Here's the final words that John has of his chapter where he gets stabbed. John fell to his knees. He found the dagger's hilt and wrenched it free. In the cold night air, the wound was smoking. Ghost, he whispered. Pain washed over him. Stick them with the pointy end. When the third dagger took him between the shoulder blades, he gave a grunt and fell face first into the snow. He never felt the fourth knife, only the cold.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay.
Another theory, John becomes resurrected. The theory could go various ways. Some believe if John's soul is preserved within Ghost, then he could later become resurrected or reborn into his original body. After all, in a fantasy world where Lady Stoneheart exists, anything is possible. Many fans believe Melisandre will resurrect John's body, which is strengthened by the fact that she's at the wall now. Another theory is that in her attempt to resurrect him, she will fail, and instead his body will be preserved in the ice cells, which are within the wall in the books and have not yet been introduced in the show. Don't know what that means.
Yeah, I'm annoyed by that.
They have like a prison that's, the walls are just carved out of ice. So you're just freezing your ass off.
There are other theories that John could, in fact, become resurrected by either Bran or the Blood Raven or Lady Stoneheart if the show ever introduces her. And, of course...
None of those things are true.
But Bran, like, at some... You know, we didn't get Bran. Bran will be back in season 6, presumably, and who knows
when he has an option for season 8.
But Bran, theoretically, has some...
Power
that could do something
to
John. I just find it hard to believe that character, especially given that, we go back to Mike Sheckle's crazy points that he made at the beginning. Like they didn't need to kill John to deliver on that show.
No, they didn't.
Because we haven't even gotten to the other stuff. So let's get to some of the other stuff. I mean, I don't think they are because it's snow and the snow had melted, so it's soft. But, Sansa and Theon could be dead. Right? They jumped off a wall.
Oh, yeah. We'll get to that in a second, too. But let me connect two of the different topics in the show, and we'll transition to that. So Melisandre comes here, and I was annoyed that Melisandre's powers and the Lord of the Light's powers are weirdly limited, right? I don't get it. It works most of the time, but in this case, it didn't work, so what the fuck, right? And so... But now that we've been talking it through, I now see how it all did work. Okay, so let me explain. So Melisandre says if you sacrifice Shireen, you will win, but every time she hedged with the you, if you remember, she would always pause with the you kind of will win, right? And she said, I saw in this episode, the Bolton banners burning, right? And I thought, no, you didn't, you bitch, and then you ran, right? No, but here's how it all connects. So she goes and resurrects Jon Snow, the Bolton Banners eventually do burn, and it's partly because the power of that leads to Jon Snow being resurrected. Somehow they march down, kill all the Boltons. So Stannis' sacrifice does work. It just doesn't work for him.
I think
she doesn't have king's blood.
I think
because he's not a king.
Because Stannis is not a king?
No, he's trying to become king. But I think that for that blood to have the power that she's talking about, it needs to be like a dynasty thing. Like, I don't think he was nearly established enough for his daughter to have any effect on it. Assuming that the sacrifice even matters in the first place.
The question,
I just don't think that she was the right person to sacrifice.
What's really gripping about her was, because she's a good actress, it was that look she gave when they come and tell Stannis that half the men left and they took the horses. And she looks, she's like, she closes her eyes, mm-hmm. right? And that, to me, could have meant any number of things. It could have meant, oh, oops, right? right, definitely could have just meant that. Or, oh, I got to get out of here, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
Or it just was like, oh, the Bolton Banners are burning because the White Walkers came through, right? Like,
yeah, I sensed the same exact
like
thing
she
you
saw,
did.
I think, but I, because I think that if you believe that she actually does have some powers to see and that she's not totally full of crap, and I half want her to be totally full of crap.
But she's obviously not. She's
right,
obviously
she
created, not.
So I think that was not just closing her eyes in an oh crap moment, but it was closing her eyes in...
in an epiphany moment.
I'm seeing something else.
Might have been.
Oh. Like, I misunderstood what I saw.
Stannis, I'm sorry, it was not you.
Yeah.
Thanks, yeah.
But I gotta run.
I gotta go, because I gotta get to Jon Snow.
Yeah,
have a good
walk. That's exactly right. She had, all throughout this season, there was this pause in her, like, wait, things are gonna work out the way I want them to, but not in the, I'm like, there's something off, there's something off. And in that moment, she realized, oh, right, not Stannis. The other thing
but if
happened.
But if that's true, then her psychopathy is unbelievable, because if she was doubting it at any point,
yeah.
she was like, let's kill the girl and see what happens.
You know? She gets kind of desperate. You know, when you're about to lose your job.
Probably right. Let's kill the girl. That'll work great. That'll be fun.
Yeah, but to her, that's irrelevant.
I got you.
So
I loved that scene. I loved her moment. That was my favorite moment of her. It was this incredibly human moment of her when Stannis gets this triple whammy of bad news. Men are gone, horses are gone, wife killed herself.
Yeah, right. Pretty brutally.
That was her Homer Simpson moment.
Don't! Yeah. that's right.
And she gave a look to Davos, too, when he's like, you know, the princess. And she's like, she actually looks like she has some humanity to her.
She does.
She's
she
like,
can't
communicates
even say
that he's.
Can't even say.
Maybe
it.
Because she did authentically believe that she needed to die from the wind. Now she realized, shit, it wasn't really necessary. Maybe she's not super bloodthirsty. Maybe she just actually believes.
So, real quick, before we totally get off him, this is, again, and all these theories, by the way, John could be a White Walker. John could lead the White Walkers, all these theories.
Yeah.
Entertainment Weekly spoke with Harrington about the season 6 finale. This is interesting. Harrington flat out told him he will not return for season 6. Quote, I've been told I'm dead, he said. I'm dead. I'm not coming back next season. So that's all I can tell you, really.
Okay, that's
he says I've been told.
He's definitely coming back.
And yep, Dan Weiss
that's
and
a
David.
That's a legalese if I've ever seen. I've studied politicians' weasel words for decades, okay? Enough to know that that means he's coming back.
Dan Weiss and David Benioff, if that's how you pronounce it, said you're gone. But again, right. Nobody is
they
saying.
They said.
Harrington had teased his return to Game of Thrones with the Huffington Post earlier this month, the story I read. When asked if he will return to set to shoot season 6, the actor responded saying, if I start filming Thrones, I can't tell you if I do.
Well, we just have to see if he signs on to a bunch of movies now.
But I'm already frustrated. Like, if he's going to come back, I am not interested in waiting until season 7, because that is April of 2017.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay, that's all right. By that time, Cleveland will have picked up some extra players. We'll have interesting NBA playoffs.
We will be 3 months into Bernie Sanders' presidency.
We'll be disappointed with him already.
Right, we'll already be mad at Bernie Sanders.
Like, oh, where's that change you were talking about, Bernie?
Right.
Oh, yeah, Song of Fire and Ice, Field of Burn.
Okay. All right, so Stannis. Really, nothing disintegrated quicker for a character. I mean, if you were looking for some guy, you know, last week it was all about how nobody's character can ever be resurrected, even on Game of Thrones. And no, they couldn't. They knew it, and that was it. And he recognized it, too. I mean, he is so prepared for Brienne to to kill him. He's like, even, you know, and even the whole Mar, he knows. He's a serious warrior, a serious tactician. Mm-hmm. So he leads these men, who he's clearly also sacrificing, into this battle. They walk to Winterfell.
Yeah. So it's in those final moments, I had a couple of funny thoughts. First, I thought, man, Tyrion fucked you up. Because if Tyrion hadn't won in the Blackwater, which without Tyrion, they would have never won in Blackwater, he'd have been king so long ago.
Right.
Yeah.
None of these tragedies would have befallen him. You know, he'd have been, he'd have had his kid, he'd have had everything.
And Tyrion, if given a chance, would be like, no, I'm going to pass.
Yeah, if he knew now.
Yeah, if he knew now. Right.
We don't know for sure, because Tywin does show up with his army like that same night too. It's possible they would have battled throughout.
And the Tyrells
King's
showed
Landing.
Up and all that stuff.
Yeah.
But he had a hell of a chance.
He had a
much
better chance.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, that was his best chance. And then, he knows he lost.
He accepts it.
Right.
You know, there's a degree of humanity in him of like, I can't believe I did this. I need to be killed.
And he's like, when he sees his wife, I think he thinks that to some extent too.
No excuses. He's like, yes.
Go and do your duty.
And she hesitates at that.
Yeah, I think she expected, like, this is the guy that I've hated for 2 years.
She expected a monster, and here was this kind of broken man.
I really liked how they did them walking to Winterfell, like, kind of a pathetic-looking force. The line, there's not going to be a siege. That's great. And then when we sometimes criticize them for doing green screening bad or compositing bad or whatever, but they know how to do, like, a rising shot of armies circling each other where it shows the scale of it, and it looks just amazing, and you realize, like, that one shot, you're like, nope, he's fucked. He's not getting out of this. There's no way that he's totally outnumbered by cavalry. I love that shot. I think they did a great job. And I also, we mentioned this before we filmed it, I like that he both goes to his death, you know, with dignity. He pulls out his sword. He's not scared. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, he's a fucked up guy, but he's not a coward. They give him that last moment of defeating those two younger
Boltons
when he's already wounded. Like, again, those are things that other TV shows I don't think really would have done. They would have wanted him to look pathetic and cowardly before he died. But Game of Thrones doesn't need to do that.
And he looked like a badass before he died, and he looked honest before he died. I mean, there's a lot of redeeming moments for Stannis, to the point where I nearly kept a Stannis stubble for this episode.
Still killed his daughter, though.
Yeah, I know. You don't get redeemed from that.
Yeah.
But you're right. That's why it's a nuanced, sophisticated, and wonderful show. Brienne of Tarth taking way too long reading the last rites, any last words. I'm like, Ramsay's behind you.
Right.
I was thinking the same thing.
Right, and I was like, oh, thank God Ramsay wasn't behind her. Okay, right. So, but she, you know, she didn't feel as good as she thought she would killing him. But
she hesitates.
Right, so this gets to the larger point, which is the theme of this episode was hatred over heroes and doing your duty and doing the right thing, right? So Brienne chooses to go kill Stannis and chooses hatred and revenge over doing her duty, which her actual duty, which is to wait for the candle, where she could have went and saved Sansa. It would have been a perfect moment to save Sansa, right?
And to go get them from the snow.
Yes,
and
exactly, right? And Arya chooses hatred and revenge over doing her duty, right? And there was a couple of other examples, but I felt like they kept coming back to that. And so, also perfectly Game of Thrones, because that's also how a lot of times real world works, but movies don't.
Ramsay's a dumb mistress, too.
Yeah,
like she
that was
got,
a good moment.
Like
for
I mean, you know, I mean, look, she's Phil. All she is hatred and revenge, but that cost her too.
Mm-hmm.
So let's talk a little bit about Dorne, because you mentioned that you were like with Brienne. Enough with the speeches, like you know, first of all, you didn't wait long enough to see Sansa's light go on. But it turned out not to really matter. But, like, because you think that Ramsay or Bolton's going to come up behind you. That's what I was positive with Jaime talking to his daughter. Because, you know, he kept saying, you know, I'm so glad, you know, you picked a great guy. How often do you fall in love with the guy you're assigned to marry? That's great. And I'm like, that guy's about to stab Jaime in the back.
No. The whole scene, I was thinking, that she might kiss him, like, oh, thank you, Daddy, and kiss him. And so I'm, like, screaming. My wife's flipping out, like, what's wrong with you? Like, don't kiss him. Right. Don't kiss him. Whatever you do, don't kiss him. Right? And so at the end, I sighed a huge breath of relief. That's not how you say it. Anyway, oh, only the princess died. God bless.
Maybe somebody we didn't know.
Right. She's dead, but not Jamie. Don't kill Jamie.
But they had the nice family moment.
They had a wonderful moment where Jamie has this human moment of when she says, you know, I'm glad you're my father. I'm so happy you're my father. And he's, like, filled with this sudden, you know, this wonderful burst of parenthood. And then, of course, she dies in what was, as telegraphed, a poison delivery scene as you can have.
Oberyn's wife. Choosing hate and revenge over the duty she promised
to her brother-in-law.
Yeah. Right.
But don't they just turn the boat around? Like,
you can see the boat. That's my question.
I think it would be
irrational if next season the boat didn't turn around. I would turn the boat right the fuck around and make sure that I brought her head home to Cersei. Otherwise, it's war and everybody dies.
Right, because
war
anyway. You can talk to Oberyn's brother.
That's right.
Be like, hey, look, she was poisoned. Let's think. Who poisons people here?
And who just kissed her?
Right, who just kissed her?
Everybody knows it.
Right, right.
And besides which, her lover, Tristan,
he might be
if he doesn't say turn the boat around,
And there's no argument that anybody can make that Jamie did it to try to start something, because then if he wanted to start something, he would
kill Tristan.
He would kill Tristan or just sail to King's Landing and then send both their heads back. Like, and then you'd have your war.
Right.
You
know?
Yeah. I did want to criticize really fast the TV thing they did, where we all sort of suspected that it was the lipstick or whatever. And so then you see the blood coming from her nose. And I actually liked that at first because I thought, oh, she was willing to sacrifice her life.
That's what I thought, too. Yeah.
Then she takes the antidote. You don't wait 2 hours to take the antidote. That boat's already, the second they're gone, you're like.
Yeah. No, your brother-in-law has been wheeled out.
Right. Yes, exactly. Right. Why'd she wait so long?
Yeah. Well, that's because they're snakes.
Yeah.
Yeah. But we know there's time. I mean, Bronn had time. She knows. They've probably taken the poison a zillion times.
I know, but I'm saying, like, if you could, it's not like it does nothing or it kills you. No, it's doing terrible damage to her insides. Anyway, it's just a TV-y thing. But yeah, it's going to be interesting to see. But also, like, starting a war between Dorne and the rest of the realms, like, we're about to start season 6. Do we need a new war? I'd rather focus on the wars we already have,
possibly. I don't think we're going to have a war with also because, you know, Jamie's a grown-up now. Jamie doesn't want to have a war, and they don't have an army to fight that war.
Yeah, that's
perhaps,
pretty much
you know, so Jamie's got no interest in that war.
Yeah, I just hope to God the ship turns around. Otherwise, again, the irrationality of it will drive me nuts.
Also, Jamie's going to go home and lead, presumably, because he's now recognizing also, hey, I'm not going to stand next to you so I can be near Cersei. My hunch is he's going to come home and be like, Tommen, we have to have a talk. Mm. Hey, I'm your dad. How are you?
Yeah. And you're not really king.
Right.
I am. Let's just move on with our lives. Yeah. Because when it came to crunch time, you were rolled up in bed. I can't have an 11-year-old leading the kingdoms. Mm. So, hey, listen, be cool. Watch everything I do. You'll have your moment.
Yeah. Right, okay. Has anyone ever more deserved?
Probably pretty soon.
Right.
Yeah. That's right.
And so that, again, ties into the earlier conversation we're having because, okay, one of the principal things I thought afterwards is, wait, Stannis is dead. Who's the rightful heir to the kingdom? Who should actually be the king? And the answer right now is no one. Mm. Stannis doesn't have any heirs. All the Baratheon brothers are dead. Renly didn't have any heirs. Robert has that bastard son.
Who's a bastard relative. Son. Bastards don't count.
They don't count unless they get unbastardized.
Right.
La, 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 la. Right. So
it would be
there
another,
is no rightful heir.
It would be another Baratheon. Some other. Joe Baratheon.
Yeah, it would be Joe Baratheon, who does not exist in the show, right? So that's kind of amazing that we've killed off all the rightful heirs, right? So, and when you think about that, it's Jamie's got to go back and lead because who else is going to, right? Uncle Kevin, right? I guess Uncle Kevin's in charge, right? But it seems again like such a minor character.
He does, Kevin. but one could also imagine that, unlike Cersei, Jaime can probably have a conversation with Uncle Kevin.
They'd probably work together.
And be like, all right, you're in charge of the war and the army, and you're my assistant, and let's go.
Yeah. So, right. Which then brings us to Cersei, because I thought several things. One is that as bad an ordeal as she just went through, the news she's about to get is worse.
Oh, another,
like Stan is saying, what news could possibly be worse?
Right.
Yeah, well, you know.
I think for him, he would rather lose the wife.
No, that's true. But for Cersei, she would rather go through that 5 times,
yeah,
10 times, whatever, than lose her daughter, right? Yeah. Which is Cersei's redeeming trait, that she cares so much about her kids.
I don't see it. I didn't care that much about her kids. I mean, she's put her kids in incredibly risky situations. She threw Tommen to the wolves to some extent. I mean, she did no actual mothering. I mean, she feels some connection to them, and I think she knows that that wins her sympathy with people. Like, you know.
No, I think she cares about her kids in a selfish kind of way.
Yeah, it's totally selfish.
I mean, yeah, like these are my progeny, and these are, and they are. And
look at these beautiful creatures I created,
and who will rule the kingdom because of me. Yeah. So I get all that. So, but that she will be devastated nonetheless because she really, really, really wanted her daughter back. Now she's dead at the hands of people she despises. Okay,
and she thought that's how it would happen. Actually,
she'd probably give Jamie a break for it though.
Yeah. So
I know you did your best, and I appreciate it. Yeah.
As she went to kiss her, by the way, Mrs. Oberyn, right? Mm-hmm. Forget Jamie. If I was the brother-in-law, I'd have almost walked. Like, be like, wait, no!
Right.
No, kiss him.
Or Bronn.
Right.
Bronn.
Well,
like,
Bronn is,
yeah, he doesn't know it well.
He was busy with his fire cap.
He'd been poisoned.
Yeah. So Cersei, okay, as she's going through that, they did it again, man. I felt tremendous sympathy towards her, okay, with the whole shaming and the walking through the city, and although some justice, okay, so I felt both, but I thought Cersei was one of the characters I couldn't feel sympathy towards, right? This is an amazing show. I mean, it's the most amazing show that's ever happened. Come on, how do you feel sympathy for Cersei? How do you feel sympathy for Stannis in his last moments? How, right? But the other thing I kept thinking about is, okay, you had a little bit of comeuppance, but the flip side is so do these motherfuckers.
Oh, yeah. Right.
And, I can't. Now, all of a sudden, I'm rooting for Cersei to unleash holy hell on them because what a terrible mistake letting her back in the Red Keep. Oh, that's a mistake you're not going to recover from.
But she'll come out for the trial.
Oh, yeah. And you know what? She confessed. So she's cleansed her soul. Mm-hmm. Oh, are you fucking nuts? I mean, she didn't know what she was dealing with in the Faith Militants, but they don't know what they're dealing with when it comes to Cersei. I mean, told my wife, again, she's there. She's like this person who's a blank slate, doesn't know Game of Thrones at all. I'm like, she's like, oh, that's terrible what they're doing to her. I'm like, well, she kind of deserves it. And plus, don't worry. She will get them back tenfold.
Yeah, totally.
Everyone you see on the screen is dead.
Right. Well, assuming she has power, Kevin might not.
She'll kill everybody in the city. Even people who aren't.
She'll go Mad King and put the light balls under the streets and whatever.
So who did my wife hate most in this episode? She felt very strongly the thing that was visceral. She's like, "What is that? What?" She was viscerally angry at one specific person in this.
Oh, interesting.
It wasn't the High Sparrow.
Shame.
Oh,
shame.
Yeah.
Shame.
Oh, the nun.
Shame. Yeah, oh, my God. She couldn't bear it.
By the way, has there ever been a better visual summary of the history of Christianity? Look at her naked body. Shame.
Shame. Funny.
Shame.
In fact, again, my wife said, why are they pretending they're against her when they're looking, when they just want to see her naked?
That's the whole thing.
That's exactly the whole thing. I'm like, well, that's a twofer. You get to shame her, and then later every male in the crowd will masturbate to it.
Yep. Right. And, I mean, some during.
There was a penis shot there.
There was two penises, at the very least, as many penises as boobs, which is rare.
And that guy runs up, and he's like, you know.
Well, the whore had the best line.
Yeah, I've had
half the cocks the queen had.
Yeah.
Which isn't technically true. But,
but then what is the point? Like these people are all, like, I mean, you're right, they're all horrible sinners. Mm. I mean, if you care about that kind of thing, or they're just people living their lives, right? But they love it. They love shaming her. Although, again, to some extent, she deserves it. Not for that. Not for any of her personal behavior. But for her complete indifference during the siege of whether anyone got any food.
Yeah, that's true.
You know?
Well, look, remember, the beginning of the crowd is the Faith Militants. But most of the crowd is actually the poor of the city who hate her for all the things she's ever done. Yeah. and because they're bitter, and
would hate any queen.
Right.
Like, they want to see someone high up fall.
And those Faith Middleton guys, they're like, you know, what they want to do is, come on, jump out in front of us.
Oh, yeah, they were looking to hit people.
Yeah, they just want to hit people.
Yeah. Look, one of the things I'm looking forward to most in season six is
get the Faith Miltons.
Oh, the Faith Miltons. Yeah. Going house on those motherfuckers. Like, you got faith. Yeah. When Cersei.
Yeah, here's who I'm not going to find sympathy for at the last moment. Any members of the Faith Miltons.
The High Sparrow, you don't think? Yeah.
No, I don't think so.
Yeah, I say get some archers. They've already got targets. Let loose.
Well, Cersei and the Queen of Thorns might rally in a realliance for a brief moment to get those sons of bitches.
Yeah, you'd think Diana Rigg could come in and sit down and be like, can we maybe have a normal conversation now?
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, Cersei, in her confession, I mean, she's clearly still manipulating him. She knows what she wants to some extent, but it's not impossible that this experience will have actually changed her in some way.
No, impossible.
She's been fairly the same. She's been pretty much the same since season one. Which in the books, she gets increasingly crazy, and it's pretty obvious that she's getting crazier. I think that she might actually suffer her real first character change in the series.
I doubt it.
They have rehabilitated people like that you didn't think could be done. I suppose they could take it with Cersei. That maybe with Diana Rigg, Cersei. Maybe they have this moment. What is her name?
Olenna? Lady Olenna.
Lady Olenna.
Queen of Thorns.
The Queen of Thorns. So maybe the Queen of Thorns and the Queen of Mean could have a conversation where they do bond, and they bond over their daughters, right? That might do it too. You could see Cersei breaking down in tears and Diana Rigg being like, all right. Maybe. Okay, a couple others. So,
but at the end of that scene, we're introduced to...
So I thought that was the last scene of the show. Right, I thought that was enough. Right, except then they even stamped that scene with, "Oh yeah, and by the way, meet Frankenstein."
Yeah,
Frankenstein's monster.
He's our new temp.
Yeah,
he's a big guy. You know, I think he's gonna go places.
Yeah. So that was what's his name? Right,
the mountain.
The mountain. Yeah.
We are led to believe.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. He didn't look too good in the eye area.
No. Well,
he needs some Visine or something.
Some mask on. Yeah, so he and the thing that the crazy doctor said, that the mad scientist said, was that he'll a vow of silence until all your enemies are vanquished.
Yeah, that might take a while with Cersei. I think that'll be refreshed from time to time.
So once again, Game of Thrones does it, where I can't believe that I'm happy the mountain is back.
Right,
right. The mountain. I mean, the most vile, vicious character in so many ways. Not in how Machiavellian he is, like Cersei, but he's just, there's a child, break its neck and drink its spine fluid, right? And here he is, and he's gonna avenge Cersei's enemies, and I'm happy.
Right.
I can't wait for that guy to go house. If you liked what I did to Oberyn, wait till you get a load of what I do to Faith Milton.
I know, but the great thing is that you and Jon Snow, and hopefully me, and probably not Jon, definitely Jon, like, we would be like, yeah, we want that revenge, we want to vanquish Cersei's enemies, but we, of course, know that we only want to vanquish those first six of Cersei's enemies.
That's right.
Right, and so you can't turn that guy loose. You can't.
Yeah. Yes.
Right.
We would be pulling a Cersei if we let the mountain loose.
On everybody.
Right. Because that'll come back to bite us.
Of course. And quickly. Yeah. Quickly. Yeah. And oh, great, the High Sparrow, all the Faith Milton. No, stop.
He's killing the townsfolk.
Right.
Not the entire House Tyrell. Oh, no.
That's right, yeah. All right, so the jump, Sansa and Theon. Obviously, they're holding hands. They finally did sort of come together. They connected. I mean, she's still rightfully angry because he had admitted in the previous episode he didn't kill her brothers. He just killed two innocent farm boys who we don't know, so we don't care. Back to the point that they were making.
Along with other people that lived and worked at Winterfell that she grew up with. There's still a lot of reasons to not like Theon. But he did throw that lady over the edge. That was a nice... By the way, if you're going to rebel against Ramsay, did he choose the worst time? Like, her skull was still sort of bouncing along the cobblestones as the door opened and
Good.
Came back in.
Good. I mean, she's an evil person and a killer. Yeah. And Ramsay should feel anguish.
Yeah, hopefully
you know, Ramsay is unredeemable, and there won't be a moment there. There won't be a redeeming moment.
No.
For Ramsay, and hopefully... But, of course, they jumped knowing they might die.
And preferring that.
And preferring death to staying there, hoping they'd live, right?
Yeah.
Right, that's why we want to do the poll, which we now can, by the way, because we have the app. Who's more vile, Ramsay Bolton or Joffrey?
Baratheon.
Baratheon.
Right.
Right. So do that on the TYT app. Everybody check that out. We'll have that up soon, immediately after this. Because that's the poll is good, because those are the two unredeemable characters.
Mm-hmm.
And Joffrey died with no redemption whatsoever, because there was no redemption to be had. He's not a nuanced character. He's just primeval. Ramsay, primeval. There's no redemption to be had. Also, I mean, I guess you can include the Mountain in that, just because he doesn't think very much.
Right, but he's a henchman.
But that's not the
same thing.
He's
not a
henchman.
He's
a henchman, right, exactly.
Yeah.
Obviously, you know, now we have this, you know, buddy comedy set up, perhaps, of Theon and Sansa.
And maybe Brienne.
That
was a long fall, man. I mean, if they're going to get back up from that, that's a little un-Games of Thrones.
Well, I'll tell you what.
That's a little bit end of Training Day.
Yeah, I got jumping off the, yeah.
Yeah.
There was snow, tons of snow, mm-hmm. which had melted, right? Uh-huh. It had warmed up. We saw it. That's when we thought things were going great for Stannis. Like, we're walking in mud, there's ice driven. So that's soft snow. So you can probably jump into soft snow.
Yeah. Although we do have to bear in mind, Ramsay loves a manhunt.
Yeah, it's true.
Oh, good point. Oh, no.
I doubt they're just going to run off, and he's like, you kids. I think he'll follow them.
Yeah, and if they get hurt from the jump, which they most certainly had to, right, I picture Theon breaking his leg and dying there, right?
Mm-hmm.
Or some vicious man.
Some sacrifice. Yeah, yeah. Theon needs to make a sacrifice to save a Stark.
Yeah, right. This wasn't enough.
Yeah.
Right.
I don't think.
And so, yes. I mean, Brienne better get back to glory, something, anything, right? At this point, I'll take who are the vicious wildlings, the Thens?
The Thens.
I'll take a Then over Ramsay, but just get to safety, get away from Ramsay, because once that manhunt starts, you are forever fucked.
He'll follow you to the ends of the earth.
Right.
He will, but the flip side is that takes Ramsay out of the safety of the castle and in out among the people and runs a risk for him.
Oh, that is good.
That'd be
because
good.
If you're running a risk and Ramsay is not well defended, and then he runs into Brienne, okay, now.
Right, yeah, Brienne. Right,
now we're having a conversation.
The only thing, I would say that she would be at a deficit against him because she fights fair. But if we recall her fight against the Hound, she's willing to fight dirty when it's necessary. She was biting his ear off and
you
throwing
know,
mud in each other's eyes.
And also, you know, Rhys, that's his dad, right?
Rhys.
That Rhys will, suppose Brienne kills Ramsay. Right, and then he sends his head back. She wouldn't do that, but something like that. Yeah. I just get the feeling Rhys would be like,
whatever. Would hardly look up from the Sunday paper.
Right, he'd be like,
onto the style section.
Like, he was a bastard. he was a bastard. I thought you unbastardized me. I never signed that. You know?
I wrote Spider-Man. and he's got another kid coming anyway.
He's got a kid coming. He doesn't care. He doesn't care at all. All right, what else we have? So the great conversation there between Tyrion, Eric Bana, and Jorah.
Yep, and Grey Worm as well.
And Grey Worm and Miss Sunday come in, and we have that terrific exchange explained. Because, you know, who's smart? Here's a smart guy, Eric Bana.
Mm-hmm.
He's like, no, you can't come. You can't really fight. I'm not saying you would be useless to us, but here's where we need you. This is your strength.
Yeah.
Run this city. Figure it out. Get this back in order. And Grey Worm will be respected, and Miss Sunday will help him, and you'll be the nuts and bolts guys, and you guys can get this done while we go on this search. And also recognizing, I know Jorah got banished, but I saw it. I'll walk with him. This guy's fine.
Yeah. As I saw Tyrion and Varys back in charge of an unruly city.
Yeah.
Okay. I thought, this is so good.
Yeah.
Meereen has never been in better hands.
Yeah. I hope Littlefinger shows up.
Yeah. And the Sons of the Harpy. It was nice knowing.
A grand old city. Choking on violence, corruption, and deceit. Who could possibly have any experience managing such a massive, ungainly beast?
I did miss you.
There have only been like three real friendships. There are four friendships in the whole show. I think I got these. I think, right?
Okay.
Jaime and Bronn.
Uh-huh.
Right? That's turned into an actual friendship.
Yeah.
Now, Varys and Tyrion.
Tyrion and Bronn, too, before.
Definitely Tyrion and Bronn. Everybody likes Bronn.
Bronn's a bro.
Totally. And I can't remember the other two, but I definitely...
John and Sam.
Sam Tarly and John.
Sam and John, right. Yeah. Sam and John, that was one of them. And maybe...
Arya and the Hound?
Maybe, no, maybe Robert and Ned. Maybe.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. Robert and Ned. Yeah. No, that's as good as it gets, but it's complicated friendship. Right. That happens in friendship.
Right. Yeah. But this is now we got it. This is these guys are buddies. Yeah. They're like and they complement each other perfectly because Varys can't, you know, he can't lead, right? He doesn't have that, but he's got the network. He knows that Tyrion has that sort of magical.
You know why they know their roles and they know that their roles never conflict.
That's right.
Yeah.
Okay. That's a huge part. Yeah. And the same with Bronn and Jaime and Tyrion. They know their roles. Their roles don't conflict. They complement one another.
Yeah.
So same with Sam and John. So the That's minute you have an overlap, like Littlefinger and anyone else,
right,
then you've got an issue, and then you're going to get thrown down.
And I wonder if we're to believe Jaime that if he ever sees Tyrion again, he'll kill him. If that was true, I didn't believe it either. But you imagine that Bronn could be like, come on.
Talk about it.
Hey. Right. I like both. You guys are great.
Yeah. Come on. Bros before hoes.
That's right.
Yeah. Don't get all worked up over Cersei.
Yeah. Come on. Cersei? Really? Yeah.
So it definitely felt like in that conversation they were having about them going out to hunt for her, I was a little bit disappointed because it doesn't feel like they're setting up an episode or two. It feels like they're setting up the whole next season for those characters.
Or for a chunk of it, certainly.
At least like the first half.
A long storyline of them looking for Daenerys. Who then we have to get to who...
I know, but the reason that that's bad for me is if it takes them a season or half a season to find her... No, I want her to already be flying to Westeros by then. Like, I want to see progress on that. It seems like we got at least another season of Meereen, which is cool. It'll be great to see them all interact, and Missandei has that really cool new outfit. I'm looking forward to that. I'll watch that for a season.
You'd like to be driving me.
But yeah, and look, that storyline is a little bit different than it was in the books, but we are largely at... We're as far now as we are in the books.
So
I honestly don't know where it's going to go.
Season 6 and 7, and then we're done?
I think they are committed through 7. I don't think
I
they have committed to that, but right now...
Because there's not enough time, just to John's point. You got to go, you got to recapture her or find her or whatever. You
got to
go resurrect John. The walkers have to get past the wall... And then the dragons have to get to the Red Keep. Jesus Christ! And then they got to fight, and then we got to find out what happens.
Are you telling me they can't do that in 20 hours?
Or maybe she doesn't.
At this pace, they can.
No,
I mean we're still messing around with the Boltons.
Right,
and everybody knows the Boltons' banners are going to burn.
I wonder the show which I'm sure you have. Like you saw when Daenerys. I had a problem, and so did somebody else. Unsure whether those were Dothraki who had surrounded Daenerys. You say they were. I thought they were, but I wasn't.
Oh, you say they are.
Yeah.
Yeah, they have the Aurochs, the Dothraki curve.
Yeah.
Right. But at one point, my wife with the Bolton, she was like, is that the Bolton banner? And I looked at her like, who do you think I am? I don't know what anybody's banner looks like.
Well, it's the upside down flayed guy.
Is obvious. Even I know that.
I don't know, but
it's a big X.
But I was like, I'm not John. I don't know the Bolton banner.
John.
Yeah.
Okay, so I thought that they might be Dothraki.
Shame.
But the problem is...
We've got to start saying that around the office.
Oh, yeah, shame.
Shame.
Well, and shame. For the Watch is going to become a super ironic...
Oh, totally.
Shame. Oh, yeah, right. I love For the Watch.
We're going to turn it into something like we're doing something good.
Yeah. No, we need to get Shame on the soundboard.
Yeah, that's
and we need to get a thing, a little, just a, you know, canasta.
Oh, get a bell. Like when Ricky Strom used to be around with the thing from the World Cup.
Oh, yeah.
Ukulele, or whatever it is.
Shame.
Okay. Anyway, so the problem is they're in Scotland, right? Mm-hmm. And the Dothraki are in the desert. So that's the thing that doesn't make any sense. So then why is this the Scottish Dothraki?
Why are they in Scotland? Because it looks like Scotland?
Yeah,
it's shot in
lush,
Scotland?
It's hills. It's green, it's hills.
New Zealand.
It's not where the Dothraki, the context we've seen them in before.
I think that they could be. And the Dothraki, they control a gigantic, it's like Westeros. Like it's a gigantic, gigantic area. Of many different roaming bands. I mean, that group looked huge, but for all we know, that's a relatively small
And you're telling me, my initial thought was, is it good that she's back with the Dothraki, or is it terrible?
I don't see why it could be. I mean, look, she's smart, you know.
And she has a dragon.
She has a dragon. That's always good to have, you know. She has that going for her, and that's good. But her having been a Khaleesi doesn't mean anything.
It wouldn't mean
anything to the group that she had led before.
But why would Dragon the Dragon bring her back to Dothraki lands?
Unless he's a dragon.
She's a dragon. She was talking to him, but I don't think he's sentient.
He's not an idiot. He knew to come to her. I mean, he's, you know.
He might have flew as far as he could until he collapsed
on
a bunch of sheep.
That's his home, right.
Because that's where you see all the bones. That's where he goes to sleep.
Oh.
So that's why, you know, that's where he chills out,
yeah.
Right? That's why he brought her. Not like, oh, she'll be able to reconnect with her Dothraki kin. No, that's why she's like, let's go up and at him.
Yeah,
and
she's
like, oh, right, he doesn't speak English. And he's sleepy, right? Which I loved. I loved that part. I didn't like when she dropped a ring, like she's one of the Brady Bunch, and if you follow this trail of popcorn.
Oh, you know, that they're going to find it, obviously.
Yeah, they're going to find it in the middle of that field. You're going to find that tiny little ring in the middle of that lush
field. I thought
she
dropped it because it was a sign of her royal bearing, that she was trying to make herself not a queen to these.
Yeah, maybe. It's possible.
Yeah, I hear you. But then I doubt it. I think it's so they'll find it. Jorah will find it.
I don't think so. It doesn't matter. They're,
okay, we'll find
either way, whether it's her intent, we're not going to know. They're going to find the ring.
Yeah. Yes. They'll find it in season 12. but the cool thing about the scimitars, though, is like, oh, cool, they might be Dothraki. Yes, they will most certainly capture her. Yes, they won't give a shit that she used to be a Khaleesi. But when she talks in Dothraki, they'll be like, whoa.
Right.
Okay, what is this crazy woman, blonde woman talking in Dothraki? And they might have heard the legend of her walking out of the fire.
Yeah, that's right. Mm.
And then when they see the dragons, they go, oh, the dragon, the thing.
And she's going to be like, no, leave him be.
Right, and they're going to be like, Misa.
Misa. Yeah.
Misa. They could be.
That's possible.
So, and then it turns into, to Ben's question, it turns into good news. Goes from bad news to good news.
A new army.
Because if you want to fight, you know, you were too worried about the odds because now ICE has got a huge advantage. Well, to your point about the 40,000 Dothraki army, well, there they are.
Yeah.
Unsullied, get a hold of ships, Dothraki army, we're back in business with the original plan.
Yeah, maybe.
That's right. Mm. And we got Meereen under control with Varys and Tyrion. Mm. We're all ready to go. Let's mount up. We're back to plus 115.
I think that's her army. I think this is going to turn out to be good news.
Yeah, for all we know, in that group, there might be some of the people that she used to be.
And I know that's his home, but I think he brought her there. Like, I don't think he's a crazy, dumb dragon. I mean, licking his wounds was fantastic. You're right. That was all great. But I think he brought her there for a reason.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's going to work out. All right, what else we got? I think
Arya.
So she's blind in the books.
Yeah, it doesn't happen in the exact same way. Like, she doesn't come across Meryn Trant. It actually is connected to the North, that storyline.
That was a badass kill.
Oh, it was very Hit Girl.
Yeah, totally. Yeah, that was Hit Girl.
That was very, yeah.
Yeah, I enjoyed that killing.
Him first before she went blind.
You know that we've gotten to a perverse world where we enjoyed that killing.
Totally.
Right? Where she gouged the eyes out. And
she prays next to him, kind of, as he's laying there, like she has no fear
and he's
whatsoever.
Begging to die.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, she made him suffer beforehand.
He had his hands out here, like, I'm going to catch the blood or whatever that spills from my neck when you slice my neck, you know. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, no, I love the kill. I love that she was actually using those faces. Like, she's already started to, like, surreptitiously, but she's already able to use that technology or whatever.
Yeah. Now that gets to my logic bone and it hits it pretty hard, like, you didn't think the God of Many Faces wouldn't notice when you took one of the faces? You thought those guys who are everywhere wouldn't notice that? You just thought there would be no repercussions?
The guy who can detect every lie?
I know you're like a child, but even you child.
Yeah. Right? She didn't care.
But then I would feel like, okay, I'm ready, right? You give, like, when they're about to give her the poison, it appears. Mm. I'd be like, well, I saw this coming. Okay, if it is what it is, then I'll Stannis it.
Yeah. She
does your
struggle.
Duty, right?
Yeah.
She's like, what? She's genuinely surprised. And then when she loses her eyesight, I'd be like, oh, okay, I get that too. Oh, thank God I didn't die. I hear you, brothers.
Right.
I can't see you, but I hear you.
But she's got to, I don't believe she's blind forever either. Or she's going to see through some,
She's going to do Starkish. She's going to do a warg thing. I think so,
probably.
Could be.
But she's got that sword. She stored the sword, you know. Mm-hmm. Like, she's got to go get that sword. A blind girl can't use the sword unless she got.
Maybe she wargs one of the dragons.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Maybe Bran and her warg two of the dragons.
The two dragons who are still in the closet.
Yeah.
Those dragons are gay, right?
Oh, that's what they're doing
down
there.
Everybody knows those dragons are gay, right?
Well, yeah,
I
mean, all the chains and stuff. What's that about?
But as Ben Carson pointed out, once you get locked up, well, you're going to turn gay.
Shame. shame.
I didn't say it. Dr. Ben Carson said it.
Dr. Ben Carson said it.
Oh, God.
All right, well.
Yeah, good scene for her.
That was a fun episode. A lot of speculation. We're going to try to figure out some way to do season one. Be fun to do in the 40 weeks we now have.
Yeah, we have a little bit of time, I guess.
We got some time. Good stuff. If we think of anything else that needs to be done, maybe we'll reconvene and chat about it.
And you know, let me just say one last thing, which is that I actually thought this season was overall was a little disappointing. Okay, I didn't love it as much as I loved other seasons, but I actually thought episode 10 was in so many ways redeeming.
Yes, I agree.
Went back to Game of Thrones. Jon Snow getting killed, the Cersei thing, amazing, right? Stannis
$50,000 a day for 4 days, $200,000 on that shot. A lot of interesting pictures online of them shooting it because they a lot of extras, not a lot of CGI.
Privacy.
Right, privacy. They had to have shot. People closed down shops in town. They, you know, they had $250,000 non-reveal clauses, like you got to shut up about it. They paid people to close up their shops, paid people to turn out. It was a big deal shoot for them. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So it was as good an episode, I think, as there was. So damn the shekels. And and it made
one of the best episodes.
And it made me feel much better about the whole season now looking back on it.
It needed it. I thought the season started up. We should actually do a full season review. But anyway, it started off okay, setting things up. Then it got slow. And then it sort of was just riding sexual violence controversy for a couple of episodes, but I thought that the last few were really good. I mean, episode 8, The Hard Home, that was one of the best scenes I think we've had. 9 was interesting, if controversial, and 10 was one of the best episodes.
We saw her ride the dragon, it was fun stuff.
Yeah.
200 security guards hired, local shops paid to shut down, cell phones banned, and everybody had to sign confidentiality agreements, fines up to $250,000 for that scene. $50,000 a day for 4 days for the walk of shame.
Well, I'm glad they did as well as they did.
All right.
And amazing from her to be willing to do that. You don't see scenes like that very often on TV. Yeah.
And now, after that episode 10, I'm really looking forward to the next season, which is great. That's where I want to be.
Lena Headey, that was a performance and super gutsy and courageous. I mean, you know, in the context of acting, but good for her.
Yeah good for her. No shame in that.
No shame.
Thanks for watching, everybody. We got to go.